Hello, in this in-class activity, we're going to cover simple correlation analysis. Now, first question, we have a small data set that give two variables. A variable X is given the student's home distance from the school. You know, one student live far away from school, 12 miles, another student live 10.5 miles from school, so on and so forth. Now, second variable, Y, give us the driving time from student home to school. So we're going to determine what is the correlation between driving distance and driving time. By using this example, we demonstrate how to use the formula of covariance, also how to use formula to calculate the simple correlation coefficient. Also, we're going to demonstrate how to conduct a significance test. Now, as we use this table to help us to organize our calculations. Now, from the formula, we know that in order to calculate the covariance between the two variables, we need to first calculate the deviations between both variables. You know, this column give us the space to fill in the deviation of variable X, and this column give us a space to fill in the deviation for variable Y. Okay, so now let's to calculate the deviation, we need to first find out the average value for both variables. So we first let's move on to this page. In this page, I already have everything calculated. Let's first look at how we obtain the average for both variables. So for both variables, we first sum up the individual values. So the sum of the first variable X is 42. And sum of the second variable Y is 75. So for both variables sum, we divided the number of cases into the sum, we obtain the average value of both variables. For example, for first variable X, the sum is 42 divided by 4, that gave us 10.5. So the mean value of variable X is 10.5. Similarly, we divide the 4 into the sum of the second variable, 75. That gives us the mean value of the second variable, Y, 18.75. Now, given this the average value of both variables, we can calculate the deviation of both variables. That is what we see here in this column. Now, by looking at the formula for deviation, that is individual value minus the average value of that variable. In this case, we have first variable, first value 12. 12 minus the average value of variable X, 10.5. That gave us 1.5. Second value, 10.5 minus the average value of 10.5. That gave us 0. Third value, 7.5 minus the mean gave us the negative 3. And the last value, 12 minus the mean gave us 1.5. So this column is a deviation for the first variable X. Now if you sum up those deviations, there are positive values, there are negative values. When you sum up, they all cancel out to get a 0. Now let's calculate the deviation for the second variable Y. The second variable Y, the average value is 18.75. So for the first case, the second variable is 26. 26 minus the mean 18.75 gives us 7.25. For the second case, the value is 18 minus 18.75 give us negative 75. Third value 7 minus 18.75 gave us negative 11.75. And the last value for the second variable, 24, minus the mean of the second variable gave us 5.25. Again, you have a positive value, you have a negative value. They should cancel out each other to have a zero sign and a close to a zero. So these two columns give us the deviation of both variables. Using the deviation of both variables, we can calculate the cross product to obtain the covariance between the two variables. The covariance, the cross product, is basically simply the deviation for the first variable multiplied the deviation of the second variable. In this case, it's 1.5 times 7.25 that gave us 10.88. We put the cross product in the last column. For the second case, 0 multiplied negative 0.75 gave us 0. Well, third case, negative 3 times negative 11.75 that gave us positive 35.25. And for the last case, 1.5 times 5.25 that gave us 7.88. So you have four values of the cross product from the four cases. You sum them up and you obtain a sum 54.01. Why do we want to do this? Because this next question, we need to calculate the covariance between the driving distance and driving time. In the formula of the covariance, on the top is the sum of the cross product of the two deviations of the both variables, and that's why we need this term, and this term exactly what this number is. So this number will go to this part of the covariance formula. At the bottom is the number of cases minus 1. So in this case, of 4 cases minus 1, we have this degree of freedom 3. Complete this calculation, we obtain a value 18. So the covariance between the two variables is 18. It has a mixed unit because the variable x has a unit of miles, and the variable y has a unit of minutes. So the 18, this value has a unit miles, minutes. Okay, so this is how we calculate covariance. So obviously it is a positive, it indicates a positive correlation between the driving distance and driving time. Now we need to also calculate the Pearson correlation coefficient. To do that, we need to calculate the standard deviation of both variables. Okay. Now, standard deviation we learned from the past is calculated by using this formula. Okay. In this formula, on the top, we have the sum of squared deviation for each over each case. Okay. Now, in this case, it is in this column. So this column gave us the deviation for first variable. For each case, we square it. 1.5 squared gave us 2.25. 0 squared is still 0. Negative 3 squared is positive 9. 1.5 squared is 2.25. We sum up this 4 squared deviation gave us this sum here. Now in this formula, on the top, we need the sum of the squared deviation. So this 13.5 simply go to the top of this formula. At the bottom is number of cases minus 1. 4 cases minus 1. That's why at the bottom we have 3. The whole thing is under the square root. So you complete this calculation, you obtain 4.5. Also under the square root. You find the 4.5 square root, you obtain this value 2.12. So 2.12 is the standard deviation of the first variable driving distance. In the same way, we can calculate the sample standard deviation for the second variable, the driving time. So this is the deviation of the driving time. And for each case, we score the deviation. 7.25 squared give you 52.56, so on and so forth. Notice that for any negative value, after you square it, it becomes positive. So after you find the squared deviation for all cases, you obtain this big sum, 218.76. In this formula, on the top is the sum of squared deviation, and that's exactly where this value will go. So 218.76 go to here in this formula. At the bottom is still divided by the degree of freedom, number of cases minus 1. So this gave us the value 72.92 under the square root. You change this just a little error here. We need to delete this. Okay, this is a carry over from the I did a copy and paste. Okay. So now we back on back on this slide. So under the square root sign, we have a 72.92. You'll find the square root of a 72.92. You have this standard deviation for the second variable, 8.54. So this is how to use. This is how we calculate the sample standard deviation, and that's so we complete this question 1C. Now the reason we want to calculate the sample standard deviation is that we are going to use those sample standard deviation to divide them into the covariance to obtain a Pearson correlation coefficient. Okay. So this is the formula we use to calculate Pearson correlation coefficient. On the top is sample covariance. On the bottom is the two standard deviation, the standard deviation of both variables. Now, we already calculated that the covariance between the two variables is 18. And the standard deviation for the first variable is 2.12. And the standard deviation for the second variable is 8.54. So you need to complete this calculation to obtain the Pearson correlation coefficient. Now, you can do this in different ways. You can use 2.12 multiplied 8.54 first and divide the result into 18. Or you can use 18 divided by 2.12 and that resulted number further divided by 8.854. This should give you the same result. In this case, the result is 0.99. So we see that there's a positive correlation between the driving distance and driving time. Specifically, the Pearson correlation coefficient is 0.99, a very long, very strong positive correlation. Next question in this in-class activity involves the significance test involving the population Pearson correlation coefficient. For this example, for this question, we have a data set. In that data set, we have two variables. From the two variables, this data set, its size is 27. So 27 cases. And from this two variables, we obtain a sample Pearson correlation coefficient and positive 0.45. And based upon this result, sample size is 27, sample Pearson correlation coefficient 0.45. Can we prove that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is significantly different from zero at the 5% level? Now let's follow through the seven-step procedure to complete this hypothesis testing. The first step, we need to set up the null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. The null hypothesis state that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is not significantly different from zero, and alternative hypothesis states that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is significantly different from zero. We're doing a two-tailed test because the way the question asked is different from zero. It did not ask whether larger than zero or smaller than zero. So it could be larger, could be smaller than zero. That's why we do a two-tailed significant test. Now, second step is to set up this alpha level. This is given by the question, 5%. And the next step, well, based upon the level of alpha, we'll have to find out a critical score. In this case, since we have a small sample, we are conducting a t-test, so we need to calculate the critical, we need to find out a critical t-score that corresponds to 5% the level of significance of the degree of freedom for this case. The degree of freedom in when we have two variables is the number of cases minus 2. So we need to find out the critical t-score that correspond to 5% alpha and 25 degrees of freedom. Okay. So if we split 5% evenly in two tails, each tail will have 2.5%, and also we have 47.5% from the mean up to this this critical t-score. Now let's go to a t-table to find out what is the critical t-score. Now let's go to a t-table that give us more decimal places. Okay. This is the t-table that we use this t-table. This t-table, oh, we just lost that t-table. Let me go to get a t-table again. Okay. Go to the t-table, I think it's this t-table. We use this t-table. So in this t-table, we use this t-table because it gives us more decimal places for the t-score right here. Since for this question, we're doing a two-tailed test, so we go to the line that says level of significance for two-tailed test. And it's 5%, so go to the column, this column, 5%. And 25 degrees of freedom, so we go to this degrees of freedom column, find out 25. So this is 25. So 25 degrees of freedom, 5% will read across, will obtain this critical t-score 2.06. Let's go back to the slide. So the critical t-score here is 2.06, positive and negative, since we are conducting a two-tailed test. Now we move on to step number 4. So we are going to convert the sample Pearson into a t-test statistic by using this formula. So in this formula, on the top is the sample Pearson minus the hypothesized the population Pearson. At the bottom is the formula for standard error of Pearson correlation coefficient. Specifically, the sample Pearson is 0.45 minus 0, which is the hypothesized value of the population Pearson. At the bottom, we did the square under the square root sign, 1 minus 0.45. 0.45 is squared divided by 25 degrees of freedom. So you complete this calculation, square root, and square root divided into 0.45. That should give us the t-test statistics from the sample Pearson, 2.52. So this is step number 4. Now step number 5 is to compare the critical t score with the t-test statistics so that we can determine whether this value that come from the sample, whether they fall in the rejection region or non-rejection region. 2.52 fall to the right of 2.06, so we know that 2.52 fall in the rejection region. So we know that for the sample Pearson 0.45, it is a rare event for the given null hypothesis. From this, we already know that for this question, we should reject the null hypothesis, because if the sample mean, if the population Pearson is zero, the probability of obtaining a sample Pearson 0.45 is quite unlikely, very small, it's quite unlikely. So we should reject the null hypothesis. But still, we need to calculate the p value. So from the, so we had to go to the t table to look up what is the probability of obtaining, what is the probability of obtaining a t-score 0.2.52. Now, 2.52, the table, the t-table that we are going to use has only one decimal place. That's why we round up. We round down 2.52 to 2.5. Let's go to the t-table. The t-table we're going to use is this t-table. In this t-table, we can find the t-score and corresponding probabilities. Now, we have 25 degrees of freedom, so we go to the page that gave us 25 degrees of freedom. We're going down until we see a corresponding t-score 2.5. T-score 2.5 and 25 degrees of freedom, that gave us t-score 4903. The 4903. Okay. The 49.3%. Okay. So come back to the slide. So that means that we look up the t-table, find out that with the t-score 2.5, and the probability of finding a t-score between 0 and 2.5 with the 25 degrees freedom is 49.03. And from this, we can calculate the p value, you know. So this is enlarged, this corner. This is the critical t score 2.06, and 2.52 is the test statistic. The test statistic 2.52 cut out a smaller corner. And we just find out that from this small corner all the way to the mean is 49.03. So from this orange corner all the way to the mean, from this point all the way to the mean in the middle is 49.03%. So that means that this orange corner itself is 50% minus 0.5 minus 0.4903. So this corner itself is 0.0097. This corner, orange corner, is 0.0097. Very small corner. Now, what is the p-value? Well, doing a two-tailed test, in a two-tailed test, the p-value is the double the size of a one corner, because the same thing could happen in both tails. So you need to consider the double the size of that corner on the one side. So the p-value is 2 times 0.0097, give us 0.0194. 1.94%, which is more, way smaller than 5%. So p-value 1.94% means that if the population Pearson is zero, the probability of obtaining a sample Pearson 0.45 is only 1.94% or even lower. So with such, so it's quite unlikely. So with the sample with the population Pearson at zero, it's quite unlikely to obtain a sample Pearson 0.45. So we know that a sample Pearson 0.45 is a rare event for the given null hypothesis. So this small p-value convinces us that we need to reject the null hypothesis. So we decide that we need to reject the null hypothesis, and we conclude that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is significantly different from zero at the 5% level. Question number three. Let's say we have a sample that sample size is 5, very small sample. Also, we have two variables, both observe normal distribution. The sample Pearson between the two variables is -0.25. From this evidence, can we conclude that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is significantly smaller than 0 at the 0.05 level? In other words, can we, you know, the sample Pearson indicate that there seems to be a negative relationship between the two variables? So we like to find out whether it's really the case for the population. And that's why we like to conduct this significance test. Now, again, let's follow through the 7-step procedure to complete this testing. We set up no hypothesis which state that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is not significantly smaller than 0, is not significantly different from 0. And the alternative hypothesis state that the population Pearson is significantly smaller than 0, so it is negative. And the 7th step, we set up alpha at 5%. Next step, based upon the alpha and degree of freedom, we need to determine the critical key score. Now, what is this critical key score? With 5% in one tail, 3 degrees freedom. Why 3 degrees freedom? The number of cases minus 2. So 3 degrees freedom on 5% alpha level, what should be the critical key score? Let's go to the table to find out. We use this table that give us degree of freedom and the corresponding T score with different level of significance. We use this T table because it contains more decimal places, the T score contains more decimal places. Now, since for this question, we are doing one tail test, go to read the line that says that the level of significance for one tail test, 5% are going down. We look for 3 degrees of freedom. 3 degrees of freedom correspond to 5% here, give us a t-score 2.35. So we use 2.35. Yeah. So in this case, the critical t-score is -2.35. It's negative because we're conducting a low tail, a lower one tail test. Now, step number 4 is to convert this sample Pearson into a t-test statistic. We're using this formula. Again, on the top is the sample Pearson minus the hypothesized population Pearson divided by the standard error of the Pearson. Now, the sample Pearson this time is negative. So -0.25 minus the 0, which is the hypothesized population Pearson correlation coefficient. And in the bottom, under the square root, you have 1 minus the squared sample Pearson, -0.25. We squared -0.25 and divided by 3. Complete this calculation, you find the square root and divide the square root into -0.25. That gives us the -0.45. So this is step number 4. Now, step number 5 is to compare the test statistic with the critical T score to see where it falls, and for the rejection region, for the non-rejection region. Now, -0.45 obviously falls to the right of -0.35. It's very close to 0. So it's very, it obviously does not fall in the rejection region. So we know that step number 5, we can make a comparison, and this obviously the sample Pearson, when you convert that into a t-test statistic, does not fall in the rejection region. It is not a real event for the given null hypothesis. The null hypothesis says that the population Pearson is 0. We know that if population Pearson is 0, the probability of obtaining a sample Pearson -0.25 is quite large. It's quite likely that you obtain seminal Pearson negative 0.25 is the population Pearson is zero. So it's not a real event for the given null hypothesis. We will have no reason to reject the null hypothesis. But still, we need to calculate the p-value. Let's go to the table. Let's find out that what is the probability of obtaining a what is the probability of obtaining a t-score 0.45. It appeared here negative 0.5 because I round up this t-test statistic from 0.45 to 0.5, because the t-table that we're going to use has only one decimal place, so that's why I round up the 0.45 to 0.5 negative. So now let's go to find out what is the probability of obtaining a t-score 0.5 given the 3 degrees of freedom. So we'll go to the t-table that shows the relationship between the probability and t-score, and go to the column that say 3 degrees freedom. Three degrees of freedom and t-score 0.5, and that gave us a probability 17.43. Can you see that? 17.43. So now let's so that we have 3 degrees freedom from the table, we realize that the probability of obtaining a t-score between the mean 0 and negative 0.5 is 17.43%. On this graph, 17.43% is this slice. So with this slice, 17.43, we know this around the corner. Around the corner starts from negative 0.5 all the way to the left, the infinity, negative infinity. So this corner is going to be 50% minus 17.43%. So this corner, around the corner, is 32.57%. It's a very large number. Now, what is the p-value? In a one-tailed test, the p-value is this corner. So the p-value is 32.57%. So 32.57% is way larger than the alpha 5% that we use as the definition of real events. So obviously, the sample mean after you convert, sample Pearson after you convert that into a t-test statistics, is turn out to be it will find out the probability for a t-score at negative 0.5 have very high probability to occur. The probability to occur is 32.57%. In other words, if the population Pearson is zero, the probability of obtaining a sample Pearson 0.25 is 32.57%. It's quite large. So definitely, the event, the fact that we obtain a sample Pearson negative 0.25, this is not a real event for the given null hypothesis. It does not contradict this statement that the population Pearson is zero. So we have no reason to reject the null hypothesis. So we make a decision that we do not reject the null hypothesis, and we conclude that the population Pearson correlation coefficient is not significantly smaller than zero at the 5% level. So we have two questions. In first question, we have a significant test, that is a two-tailed test. In this example, we conduct a one-tailed significant test. For the similar reason, we can also conduct a upper one-tailed significant test, as you can see in the assignment. Thank you very much, and see you next time. goodbye.